So I welcome you all to my Excelsior Academy, and what I will be doing is the summary series of Laudish, okay, which is meant for the mole bio of the cell. So we are starting with biomembranes, the cell architecture. So in this we are going to talk about how the plasma membrane functions, what is the structure, who found out about the plasma membrane, the fluid mosaic model, okay, and then what are the different types of phospholipids which are present, which is making the lipid composition of the plasma membrane, how it is different from the other membranes, then there are certain transporters which are present in that, how it is, you know, helping in the diffusion or in the transport of the molecules from one side to the other side, and whatever the techniques are there which was used to study all the cell biology theory, all are going to be discussed in between simultaneously. So what we are doing is we are doing cell bio along with the methods in tools and techniques in that unit. So two units are going together. Okay. So yes. So prokaryotes are, so we all know already about the prokaryotes and the eukaryotes. So prokaryotes are about 1 to 2 micrometer in length, and they are also surrounded by a plasma membrane, and they do not contain any internal membrane. So this we know, that it has got only one surrounding plasma membrane. On the top of it plasma membrane, there is a cell wall also. Correct? Yes, cell wall it is mentioned over here. Now, if the bacteria, if the prokaryote is meant for infection, then it has got another layer of capsule. Okay. Now, this capsule helps in the infection as well as it protects the bacteria from the harsh conditions of the surroundings. Now, most enzymes and metabolites are thought to diffuse freely within the single internal aqueous compartment. So, on the top of this plasma membrane also, the prokaryotes, they have got certain protein transporters. Okay. So, these are the transporters which help in the passage of molecules. Passage of molecules. And certain molecules like oxygen or CO2 or N2, this we know that they can diffuse passively. What do you mean by passively? That is?
They don't need energy.
Very good. It doesn't need any kind of energy, and it can just pass through around the concentration gradient. Okay. Yes. Whereas in case of eukaryotes, the chemical reactions would be limited by the diffusion of small molecules against the organelles. Each organelle is surrounded by one membrane having unique complement of protein embedded in its membranes. What does it mean? Also in its aqueous interior and lumen, it means that the components which are present in lysosomes is different from what is present in mitochondria. Obviously, right? Because each component or each organelle has its own unique function, and hence it has got its unique enzymes or the metabolites present in order to carry out its function. Now, these proteins enable each organelle to carry out its characteristic cellular functions. The cytosol also contains its own distinct proteins. So many your soluble enzymes or soluble proteins are present in the cytosols. Any example can you give which is present in the cytoplasm? Any example of the enzyme in case of eukaryotes? Yes? Many are there. So you can also talk about glucokinase or hexokinase, because we know that glycolysis happens in the cytoplasm. Okay. So there are many are there. Now, all biomembranes form closed structures, separating the lumen on the inside from the outside, and are based on a similar bilayer structure. It controls the movement of molecules between the inside and outside of a cell and into and out of the organelles of eukaryotic cells. So this is the important role played by the plasma membrane. Now, here in case of plasma membrane, what I want you to remember is its structure. Okay, so what the structure is talking about here, so you must have heard of integral proteins, correct? And there is something called peripheral proteins. So this you must be knowing. Okay, Now, what do you mean by integral proteins? Rinki?
Yes, ma'am.
What do you mean by integral proteins? So they are the proteins which are embedded into the plasma membrane. Okay, like this. The example.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So the main portion, the main part of the integral proteins, like in the case of RBC, what we are going to study in future is, we have got band 3 proteins. Okay. Then we have got glycoforins. So these two are very important proteins to remember as integral proteins. Okay. So integral proteins are also called transmembrane proteins, which is actually crossing the phospholipid bilayer of your plasma membrane. Then we have got peripheral proteins. Example is enkyrin. Okay. Abducin, spectrin, etc. So these are the examples of peripheral proteins, and this all, whatever names I've said, it's respect with the RBC, because scientists used RBC as a model cell in order to study the plasma membrane structure. Okay. Then we have got glycolipids, phospholipids, and then glycoproteins are there. So what does it mean if this protein is there? Let us consider this one. So it is a protein having a sugar moiety, so it means it is also a glycoprotein having a sugar residue. Now mainly the function of glycoprotein is in cell recognition, okay, or otherwise we can say that in cell signaling. Please remember, and all your glycan region are exposed outside the plasma membrane. Okay, it is present in the outside. You don't have inside. That is, here you won't have any carbohydrate moiety. Whatever you are going to have, it is going to be present on the outer face of the plasma membrane. Clear? Yes, and then in between we have got the cholesterols. Okay, now why cholesterol is needed? Because when we are going to study
packaging,
not packaging exactly, it is about the membrane fluidity. Okay,
yes, ma'am.
Yes, now so we are just going to go with the overall view of the plasma membrane. Okay, so this is like eukaryotic cell architecture is given, and see, so over here what you see is that this black color thing, they are showing the as internal membranes. Okay, so on this internal membranes you have got all your integral proteins. Okay, otherwise the embedded proteins, the correct word is integral or the transmembrane actually. Then we have got the internal membranes over here around the mitochondria, around your Golgi, around the nucleus, around your ER. Now what you have to remember is that except nucleus, mitochondria and chloroplast, rest all organelles have single biomembrane. Okay. And all these nucleus, mitochondria, chloroplast have got the double membrane system. So they have got the outer. So outer will be there, then inner will be there. So in the outer membrane, they have got the outer surface and inner surface of plasma membrane. Then in inner membrane also, outer and inner is there. Now this between is called the intermembrane space. Okay.
Yes.
Only in the case of nucleus, mitochondria and chloroplast. I'm sure this you all must be knowing. Now what over here is, see, then different types of organelles are there, vesicles are there. They have got the, they have to carry out the special functions such as gene expression, energy, production, membrane synthesis and intracellular transport. Now what from here we are showing is that the cytoskeleton, which one of these are the cytoskeleton? The green color ones. Can you see these ones? These lines, what you see, right? These are your cytoskeletons. So can you name what are those three cytoskeleton proteins? Huh? Anyone? Mahima, do you remember? Cytoskeleton proteins. I'm sure you must be knowing. It is your actin. Okay.
Myosin.
Then intermediate filaments. Then what is the last one? Yes.
Myosin.
No. Myosin is your motor proteins, which functions on actin filaments. Then you have got tubulins.
Microtubules. Huh?
Microtubules, right? Okay. So tubulins or microtubules of your which spindle fibers have formed. Okay. So it shows this much area has been covered. Okay. Now, what you have to understand here is that if you have got a surface like this and certain things in the form of small units of this A and of this B, which of these are going to cover the maximum surface area? It is going to be your this form. Okay, and that's why your cytoskeleton is present always in the scattered form. So I'll share one video with you guys in which you can see how beautifully the actin filaments and the microtubules, all these intermediate filaments. So intermediate filaments will be present over here wherever villi are there. Microvilli are there. Over there you have got intermediate filaments. And everywhere in the cytoplasm you have actin filaments. Then where do you see microtubules? Whenever there is a spindle formation during mitosis. Okay. So you can see that very beautifully all these three proteins are spread across the cytoplasm of the cell. Okay. And very nicely, like you must have heard of protein sorting. Like suppose this mitochondria should be present here, or the ER should be present here, or your Golgi should be present here. Lysosome should be present at the back of the nucleus. So there are certain proteins like kinesin and dynein, which we'll study later. They help in the positioning of these organelles. Okay. So what you have to understand here and remember is that each organelle in the cell, okay, is not present randomly. Like how in our body we have got kidney, heart, lungs, stomach in its own proper place, right? In the same way, in the cell also, each organelle has been placed in its correct and particular position. If it moves here and there, that is their function. But if it doesn't come back to its original position, then something is wrong with the cell. So just whenever we study about a cell, just imagine you're talking about your own body. Okay. So something goes wrong within the cell, it means the cell has to die then. So then it undergoes the apoptosis. Stop me in between if something is not clear. Okay. Yes. So then with the help of the electron microscope, they came to know that it is made up of two layers of phospholipids, which is present in the cells, and it forms a sheet-like structures of about 3 to 4 nanometer thick. So this region they are talking about is 3 to 4 nanometer thickness. Okay. Now, how these were done? So they have taken the RBC, okay, and made thin sections. It was stained with osmium tetraoxide, which binds strongly to the polar head groups of the phospholipids. And that's why you see over here, the two lines are there. Okay. So those are the polar heads. So now we know that polar heads are present on both the sides, forming the outer region and the inner region. Now the hydrophobic region came as transparent because there was no staining. Okay. And this region is also called electron light region, or in the other words, this polar region is called electron dense region. this is the transparent region, and these two lines what you see over here is also called electron dense region. Now why all these words I'm telling you? Because in the exams directly it is not said that the polar head groups or the hydrophobic region they are talking about. So they will just talk about electron rich or electron less or electron dense or transparent region. Okay. Yes. And from this they understood that it has got the two layers. So mathematically what they did was, so they calculated the surface area. Okay. So mathematically how they did, they calculated the surface area. Surface area of one membrane. So they took the weight of RBC, estimated the weight of one RBC, okay, calculated the surface area of one RBC. Now, when they calculated the surface area of one RBC membrane and then did the actual experiment, in the actual experiment, they found that it was twice the surface area calculated for the one. But we know that in the experiment we have taken one RBC, but again and again after repeated calculations we are getting twice the surface area of the membrane. So when they did this electron microscope microscopic study, they found that it is not single membrane but the double membrane. Hence the mathematical as well as the instrumental calculations were then correlated, and now we know that the plasma membrane is made up of lipid bilayer. Okay, now the lipid bilayer has got two important properties. So what are those two important properties? So hydrophobic core is impermeable barrier that prevents the diffusion of hydrophilic solutes across the membrane. So this, it's very clear because of its hydrophobicity. Now what is present in the hydrophobic core? It is the fatty acids or fatty acyl chains are there, correct? So because of this, what happens? The polar or the ions are not able to cross the membrane. Okay. Now, if I ask you a question over here, among O2, H2O, glucose, and calcium 2 plus, which is easily permeable to plasma membrane? I repeat. Among oxygen, water, glucose, and calcium 2 plus, which is easily permeable to plasma membrane? Anyone?
Oxygen.
Yes. Someone said what? Oxygen.
Oxygen.
Yes. So the correct answer is oxygen. Now, which is the last one?
Water.
Last. So if I have to make, so O2 is more permeable, then it comes the water. After water, it will come which one? Glucose or calcium?
Glucose.
It is the glucose. So first, second, third, and fourth. Now why this is fourth? See, these both are polar, but the size of water is small as compared to the glucose. So this will come. Now, if you have the charges, then it becomes the last one to pass through the membrane. Okay, it cannot actually cross itself, the permeable membrane. It cannot cross the membrane itself. So to cross any ions, we are going to study later that they needed carrier proteins. Okay. So now it's clear. So permeability, so first it will be oxygen, water, glucose, and then last will be your calcium. Now, so the presence of membrane proteins mediate the transport of specific molecules across an impermeable membrane. So this which we will study later, talking about the transport proteins. Okay. Now, membrane stability, which is maintained by hydrophobic and van der Waals interactions between the lipid chains. Please remember this, many a times I have told students. So they think that it is only the hydrophobic interactions which keeps the phospholipid bilayer together. It is not, it is also the van der Waals interactions. Okay. So along with the hydrophobic interaction, it is the van der Waals interaction which is keeping your membrane bilayer together. So even though the exterior aqueous environment can vary widely in ionic strength and pH, the bilayer has the strength to retain its characteristic architecture. So whatever happens if you put the lipid bilayer into the water having of different pH, what happens? They tend to come together and form a sheet-like structure. If it is in small in volume, so it will form a spherical shape. Okay. Now when membrane is put into the water and it takes a spherical shape, it is called dash. Any idea what it is called? It is called liposomes. Okay. So they have got structure something.
Can please repeat?
See.
Please.
So if you take a small piece of membrane, okay, if you take the small piece of membrane and put into the water, so you have taken this membrane, lipid bilayer membrane you have taken and you have put into the aqueous condition, that is some water and all. So what will happen? Because of this hydrophobic and van der Waals interaction, it won't remain like this. It will take the spherical shape. We know that, right? Whenever you drop oil into the water, what happens? It takes the droplet, a spherical shape, right? Now, when this takes the shape of the spherical, it becomes something like this. So this is your inner, this is your outer, okay? And center is the cavity. This entire thing is called liposomes. Now it's clear, Mahima? So center there will be a cavity, nothing is there, and this membrane will form a spherical. Yes.
Ma'am, if they are called liposomes, then measles, what are measles?
Measles is single membrane.
Okay.
It will be like this. It's a single, so sorry, my diagram is so bad. It will be something like this. Okay. So measles are single membrane. So if it is put into the aqueous solution, so polar region will be outside facing the aqueous region and all your hydrophobic, the fatty acid will come together in the close. So this is your hydrophobic region. This is your hydrophobic region and then this will be your hydrophilic region to which your phosphate groups are, the phospholipid phospho groups are facing the aqueous solution and inside you have got the fatty acid chains. Okay. So micelles are single membrane, liposomes are double membrane. Okay. Now you can have micelles of two types also. So just let me tell you here itself, since we are talking about micelles now. So one is where you have got like this. So polar head is outside. Okay. Now second one is where you have got the just opposite. It is going to be like this. So your polar region is going to be inside. Now, what is that condition? What is that condition? This is when it is dropped in aqueous condition. Okay. And this is when it is dropped in the opposite way. Some oil or something else. So, whatever the polar region is there, then they will try to come together, avoiding the contact with the hydrophobic region. When they are in the aqueous solution, then all the phospho groups of the phospholipid will go outwards and the hydrophobic tail will come inside. Okay. So two types are there. Yes. So now these are just the variations in different cell types. So you can see that even though we are talking about one single plasma membrane, right? But from cell to cell, it functions differs. Now let us say for the example about the RBC. Now in the RBC, you see that it is having the biconcave structure, right? So this and all, you know why it has got biconcave structure and why we have taken RBC to study the plasma membrane. Yes, can you tell me why RBC was selected to study the plasma membrane structure? Because
it has only plasma membrane.
No, you can say that it has only plasma membrane, but yes, it doesn't have other organelles. It doesn't have nucleus. Okay, so the other organelles and nucleus are not interfering in these studies. So because of which it was very easy to say that the membrane, what they quantify in order to get the surface area, was belonging to only the RBC membrane and not to the other organelles or nucleus. And that's why they will use RBC. Good. So it has got a smooth, flexible membrane covers the surface of the discoid erythrocyte cell. Now the important transmembrane protein which is present on RBC is your band 3. Okay. So I'm telling you here itself, you have to remember. And glycoforin, because this will come again and again in all the chapters. Glycoforin A to E. Okay, please remember or note down. Then you have got the tufts of cilia, okay, which are present on your intestinal lumen also, or the brain vertical. So you can see that single lines are there. So these are all covered by the plasma membrane like this. Okay, now for example, if we are talking about the epithelial line, then it has got your GLUT4 as your protein transporter, mainly expressed by, because in the intestine we need more glucose absorption. Okay, then what is this? We are talking about the myelin sheath, so it is all obviously talking about the axon nerves or your brain nerves, right? So this you can see over here, the axon is there, the terminal is there, and the myelin sheath between is also present. Can you see? Sometimes the electron micrographs are very complicated. Most of the time we don't understand itself. So here the many nerve axons are enveloped in a myelin sheath. We know this, composed of multiple layers of modified plasma membrane. Please remember, and okay, we'll come to that later. The individual myelin layers can be seen in this electron micrograph of a cross-section of the axon. The myelin sheath formed by adjacent supportive cells. So, I hope you remember, if I draw a rough structure of a cell, so something like this it has got, right? And on the top of this, we have got the myelin sheath, something like this. Okay. Yes. So this is nothing that, even though we are talking about plasma membrane, but it is dealing with different types of cells having different types of functions. Now, if you take the sections of these plasma membrane, it is going to be same. What makes them different is the presence of the transmembrane proteins. Okay. And that's how you understand that, okay, this particular cell is belonging to this category, that this is RBC, this is your macrophages, etc. It is your the presence of the membrane proteins which is helping you to distinguish between these cells. Okay, now this is just the representation how a lipid composition and the structural organization has been done. Okay, so the plasma membrane is a single bilayer encloses the cell. So this is what they are talking about, this single one. Okay, one second. So now in this you can see that the internal cytosol has been shown. Okay, and then it is talking about the, see over here you can see that the plasma membrane has been labeled over here. Then inside, small green things are there. This is your cytosol. Okay, then you have got the exoplasmic bilayer. So exoplasmic bilayer means this side which is facing. This is internal side of the plasma membrane facing the internal side. This is one is the outside. So it is exoplasmic. Now then you have got the vesicles, organelles having the single membrane and their internal aqueous space. So you can see over here, inside also so many things are there. Here also, here also, here also. Three organelles, nucleus, mitochondria and chloroplast, they have got the two membranes. So this is already has been said. The exoplasmic faces of the inner and outer membranes around these organelles border the intermembrane space between them. That is this portion. Okay. Or this portion. This is very important because the presence of different enzymes at the intermembrane space is actually driving the functions of your nucleus, mitochondria and chloroplast. Okay. Now, this is what I was telling. So, if you have this layer facing the extracellular, it is called exoplasmic. If it is facing the cytosol, it is called cytosolic. Now, one small question, whether the cytosol and cytoplasm, does it mean same? Does this mean same? Yes, Mahima? What do you think?
No.
No? So, what is it?
Cytosol is only outside the organelles.
And then cytoplasm?
But cytoplasm includes all the things.
Yes, very good. Very good. I'm so happy. Yes, very good. So cytosol is your these portions only, whereas cytoplasm includes the everything. Very good. Okay, so now we are going to talk about the lipids which are found in the biomembrane. So there are three classes are there: phosphoglycerides, sphingolipids, and the steroids. So in few books, it is also written as phospholipids. So phosphoglycerides, phospholipids, same thing. Now they are amphipathetic in nature. So what amphipathetic in nature? It means it has got both polar as well as hydrophobic core. Okay. Now what is the polar group over here? It is always the OH group. Okay. Now, in the case of phospholipids, you have got the phosphate group as well. Now, the hydrophobic effect and the van der Waals interaction, it causes the tail groups to self-associate into bilayer with the polar head oriented towards the water. So, this is, so as already mentioned, so this phospho group is facing towards the aqueous part. So, let it be extracellular or your cytosolic side. Okay, so this is something which we already know. Now, phosphoglycerides, they are the derivatives of glycerol 3-phosphate. So, all your phospholipids has been derived and synthesized from the glycerol 3-phosphate. And from where do you get the glycerol 3-phosphate? In the cell? Yes? Glycerol 3-phosphate. Something,
glycolysis.
Very good, very good. So, I was framing my questions, but yes, it is the from the glycolysis, you get your glycerol 3-phosphate. So, if you see that, it's not that only from the glycolysis glucose, at the end we get the pyruvate and ATP. So, in between certain intermediates are there. So, these intermediates will be used, for example, in the phospholipid synthesis. The others are there which will go into the pentose phosphate pathway. The others are there which will go for the some formation of the other things, right? So, there are many ways. So, all these reactions are interconnected. So, the phosphoglycerides, it consists of hydrophobic tail, which is having two fatty acyl chains. So, we have got two fatty acyl chains, and that's why we make a diagram always like this. Okay. You have got the phosphate group as well as the two fatty acyl chains. Now, which varies? So, this also we know. So, there are five different types of phospholipids and the variation is there in the group which is attached to the phosphate group as well as in the chain length of the fatty acyl. So, we also know that in the phospholipids, either you can have saturated fatty acids or unsaturated fatty acids. Okay, we'll come to this later. Then it has a polar head group attached to the phosphate group. Now, for example, in phosphatidylcholines, so, from now onwards, I will be saying phosphatidylcholines as PC. The most abundant phospholipid in the plasma membrane has a head group consists of choline. So, if you see the structure over here now. So, this is the basic general structure for all the phospholipids. Now, at the phosphate group, if you have got the choline group, it becomes PC. Ethanol amine. E is for your ethanol amine. It becomes your PE. Now, if it is serine, you get phosphatidyl serine, PS. And if it is inositol, then it becomes your PI. Okay. So, So among all these, so there are four. The fifth one is your sphingolipids. The fifth one is your sphingolipids. Now, among all these five, the most abundant is your PC. Okay. Now, this is something which you have to remember. So, all these phospholipids are present asymmetrically. What does it mean? Asymmetrically means, it means that the composition of outer membrane as well as the inner membrane is going to vary. Okay. So, for example, sphingomyelin and your PC are present on the outer membrane of the plasma membrane. What you have to remember is phosphatidylcholine and sphingomyelin are present on the outer. Rest all, PE, PH, PI are present on the inner side. So this you have to remember nicely. Now one thing what you have to also remember is that if the phosphatidylserine which is present on the inner side, that is your serine is present on the inner side, and if the cell, something goes wrong with the cell, what happens? It has to undergo something called apoptosis. Okay, so it has to undergo the apoptosis. Now what is the signal that the cell has to undergo the apoptosis? That the movement of phosphatidylserine from outer to the inner. So what is happening now? The phosphatidylserine will go to the outer side. Now this PS is present, now exposed, right? In the tissues or in the cells, it is exposed. So now this phosphatidylserine is exposed. This will be recognized by the other signals, and the entire cell will go under the apoptosis. Okay. So this is just the one statement about how the apoptosis starts. We'll study in detail once we start doing the cell signaling. Okay, so am I clear till here about the apoptosis part? Now one more thing. See, I'm afraid that you might get confused also, but please make sure that you're making notes also. So whenever I take something in one slide, sometimes what happens is I'll be adding more and more points because that comes to my mind. So I just want to add. Now apoptosis is there. In exam, every time you won't get this word, okay? You might get as PCD. What is PCD?
Programmed cell death.
Correct. Whether it is one or two. See, there comes a problem. So apoptosis is also called programmed cell death, but it is either the part one or part two. Rinki, any idea? No. So apoptosis is your PCD1. Then what will be your 2? So is there any other activity which is similar to apoptosis which happens in the cell if something goes wrong? So apoptosis means entire cell will go for the suicidal, correct? Now suppose it's only the small part of the cell which is not functioning properly. So cell will try to eliminate that particular small portion only, then it undergoes dash. What is that?
Necrosis.
What is it?
Necrosis.
No, necrosis is the death of the entire cell. It's not even the cell, the entire tissue. See, apoptosis for the entire cell. Okay. Now the PCD 2 is for something which goes wrong inside one of the organelles. So the cell will try to eliminate that particular organelle, and it is done by how? What is that process called? And the cell functions as normal. Okay, I'll tell you the answer. It is autophagy. Okay, so when I said that few organelles only, so sometimes it is the mitochondria or any, you know, peroxisome or whatever which is present. If it is not able to function properly, it goes and fuses with the lysosome, correct, and becomes the phagosome, and then entire organelles has been replaced. Okay, Please remember. See, that's why I knew that many people doesn't know about programmed cell death too, that it is also called autophagy. Okay. So this was all about the phospholipids. What you have to remember is about the PS. So it is actually present on the inner leaflet of the plasma membrane, but during apoptosis, it goes into the outer membrane. Okay. Now one more thing. So when you do any research in the lab, okay, you need to identify, for example, if I'm discovering, I'm a cancer specialist. So I'll be designing drugs in order to treat cancer. So I'll be growing the cancer cells. So what is my target? That my drug is able to kill the cancer cells and not the normal cells. So I have so many cancer cells. I'll add the drug to that. And after some time, I need to see whether the cells are undergoing apoptosis or not. Okay. So how I'm going to do? So there are certain dyes which detects the presence of apoptosis. So that you have to remember. For example, one is annexin V FITC. Okay. Now FITC is something which gives you the fluorescence. So annexin 5 goes and binds to PS. So now this binding is only possible if the PS is exposed outside. Now, exposure of PS is on outside is only possible when the drug is able to induce apoptosis in the cell. Getting the point? So I have my drug over here. Okay, it has induced the apoptosis. What will happen then? The PS is present now, it is exposed outside. And now my annexin V FITC can bind. Okay. Now, if I see now in the fluorescence microscope, only the cells which has undergone apoptosis will be visible to me. Correct? And this is how I can prove that my drug has the power to become anti-cancer agent. Is it clear the experiments, how we are going to conduct? So now I can have different doses of my drug also. So if I get MIC 50 very less for at least 50% of apoptosis, that concentration is going to be my optimum for drug development. Okay. Clear? Or was it too much? Yes. Okay. So again, so let's talk about this one more type also. That is the plasmologens, which is again a group of phospholipids. So till now we were talking about the PC, PE, PI and PS. Okay. Now it contains one fatty acyl chain attached to glycerol by an ester linkage and a long hydrocarbon chain attached to glycerol by ether linkage. Now this is one is the important thing to remember, that your plasmologens have got the ether linkage. Now, this ether linkage provides more stability to this phospholipid. Okay. Now, these molecules constitute about 20% of total phosphoglyceride content in the humans. So, mainly, where do you find this? In your brain tissues. In your brain tissues. And the heart tissues, yes. So, please remember, it is the ether linkage. Ether linkage, which makes more stable than the other phospholipids and provides the more stability, mainly found in your brain and the heart tissues. So this is the structure. So you can see that the difference is over here. So this is one is your normal phospholipid, that's the diacyl phospholipid, and here you have got the ether bond. Can you see the ether bond over here? The difference, can you see? It is the ROR kind of thing. Okay. So you can see over here, this double bond is present over here. Okay. So because of this, it is providing more stability to your membrane, and those membranes are present in the brain as well as the heart tissues. Okay. Thank you for watching, and if you have any doubts or any comments are there, you can also comment us in the YouTube channel Excelsior Academy, or you can write to us at excelsioracademy1220@gmail.com. So what I've done over here is I've started the summary series of Laudish, which is going to cover maximum part of the cellular organization, that is unit 2 of the CSIR UGC NET Life Science syllabus. Similarly, the biochemistry summary series of Leninger is also has been started. If you get time, if you are interested, you can also watch that. So from this, what you have to do is you have to just watch the video in limited number of times only, and you don't have to study the entire textbook. So your work has been minimized with the help of making the videos. So I hope you like the strategy, and it really is going to help you in covering your most of the syllabus. So all the standard books has been taken over here for the reference, and it will help in the preparation. So thank you once again from Excelsior Academy, Master Dr. Ruby Singh. Thanks a lot.